Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. This is a declaration of faith number 11. Topic is Gospel of Jesus Christ is to obey His commandments. Gospel and salvation are part of evangelical Christianity. We know what they are. However, the devil is a deceiver who deceived Eve from the Garden of Eden, and he still deceives Christians. But we think that nobody can deceive us, and so we will have no problem. The gospel is that Jesus died on the cross for our sins, and if we believe it, we are saved. So this is the nutshell. They preach it in little different ways, but this is a message we all preach. The Bible says that Jesus is the author of the gospel, and he preached the gospel. But Jesus did not preach to believe his death and resurrection as the gospel of our salvation. If Jesus did not preach that message as the gospel, if we preach it as the gospel, then we are preaching another gospel. If our gospel is true, almost all Christians will go to heaven. But if it is another gospel, we all will go to hell. It looks like that Satan do not have to deceive us, and we are very much capable of deceiving ourselves. We talk about eternal life and glorious heaven, but do we actually believe it? I don't think so. It is our religiosity. Heaven is not a ghost story. It is real. If you really believe that heaven is the most glorious, prosperous, joyful, happy, long life of reality, and you can have an inheritance there, will you take it for granted, that inheritance? Or will you make sure that you will have that inheritance? I think that you will make sure of that inheritance. You are not doing it because you do not believe in that inheritance. You actually believe it, and you will pursue, and you will make sure that you will get that inheritance. Heaven is not a folk story, but it is to you. You think just, it is just heaven. If you die, you will go to heaven. That's the way you think. But heaven is real. It's not just an old woman's story. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the only author of the gospel. Isaiah prophesied that Holy Ghost will anoint Jesus Christ, who will send from heaven to preach the gospel. Isaiah chapter 61 verse 1 says, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek, and he hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted," and so on. And the prophecy is fulfilled in Jesus Christ in Luke chapter 4, verses 17 to 21. Let me read Luke chapter 4, verse 17. "And there was delivered unto him the book of prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me.'" He took the prophecy reference from the book of, from the scroll of Isaiah, and he is reading it for himself. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering the sight of the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised." Verse 20, "And he closed the book and gave it again to the minister and sat down. All the eyes of them that were there in the synagogues are fastened on him." Verse 21, he says, "And he began to say unto them, 'This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears.'" That is, the scripture fulfilled in Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ only. It did not fulfill in anybody else. So he is the only author of the gospel. And so if he's the only gospel, and only author of the gospel, and he has authority to preach the gospel, to initiate the gospel, he's the beginner of the gospel message. He preached the gospel when he was a man. All over. So Matthew chapter 4, verse 23 says, "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom. Mark 1 says in verse 14, now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying that the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the gospel. So, Jesus Christ did preach the gospel, taught his disciples to preach the gospel, and sent them also to preach the same gospel that he preached. If any of us, if we preach the gospel, we must preach the same gospel that Jesus Christ preached and his disciples preached. We have no authority to turn any other message to preach it as a gospel. We can preach anything if it is true, but don't preach it as a gospel. Gospel is a message which will take us to heaven. That's the message. No other message, even if it is true, if you believe some truths, something, somebody killed somebody, that is a true message. If you preach it, you just speak as a truth, that will not take us to heaven. What Jesus Christ preached as the gospel, that is a message, will take us to heaven. And Luke chapter 9 verse 1 says, he called his 12 disciples together and gave them power and authority over the devils to cure diseases and send them to preach the gospel of the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. And they departed and went through the towns preaching the gospel and healing everywhere. Jesus Christ gave his disciples power and authority over the devils and heal the diseases. Gospel is for eternal life and healing is for a sign. Nowadays, or maybe the mind of the people was taken by the miracles and the healings and the excitement and all these kind of things, were carried away by those kind of things. But those other things are signs to show that they are the servants of God. The message they preach, the gospel they preach, if you listen, hang on to that message will take us to heaven. If you hang on to the miracles and the healings, that will not take us to heaven. Those are telling us that they are the people of God. It's a signs. We have to know the difference between the sign and the gospel. The gospel will take you to eternal life. The signs will not take you to eternal life. Give some benefits on this earth. Eternal life is for those who believe Jesus Christ and obey the gospel of Jesus Christ. Then only we will reach eternal life. Even Holy Ghost is given to those who obey. Acts 5, chapter 5, verse 32 says, we are his witnesses of these things, and so the Holy Ghost, whom God gave to them that obey him. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9 says, and made, he was talking, referring to Jesus Christ, he was made perfect, and he became the author of the eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. If you do not obey him, his gospel will have no effect on us. Jesus Christ did not preach to believe his death and resurrection as the gospel for salvation. And the message, death and resurrection of Jesus Christ is preached by us and our preachers. We must believe that as a prerequisite for the gospel. We believe his death and resurrection, then we know that he is God, and then we'll have incentive to believe what he says. The disciples preached Jesus Christ as the author of the gospel and preached his commandments as the gospel for the people to obey so that we may inherit his kingdom. All other gospels are another gospels. They will deceive us. And Jesus Christ replies to a man in Matthew chapter 19. He asks, good master, what good things shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? Jesus answered, if thou enter into life, keep the commandments. He tells him to obey the commandments in order to inherit the kingdom of God. Now preachers say that's the Old Testament, that's for the Jews, we are by grace, we are all kind of garbage they preach. But they talk about Paul very highly, they selected verses from Paul so that they may twist it to preach another message. This Paul says, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7. Let me read the 2 Thessalonians, chapter 1, verses from verse 7. And the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if we do not obey him, he will take vengeance in flaming fire. It is what the scripture says. I'm not saying it's what the scripture says. Jesus comes with flaming fire to take vengeance if you do not obey. He takes it seriously. Verse 9 says, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. Verse 10, he shall come to be glorified in his saints and be admired in all them that believe in that day. So he will punish those who do not obey, but if we obey him, we will be glorified in him and with him. Most Christians laugh at these scriptures, but it is not a hoax. It is real. It is scripture. The Lord Jesus Christ came unto his disciples after his resurrection and told them to preach the gospel. So how did he tell them? See, Mark records that, and Matthew records the same message which Jesus Christ told them, give baptism and so on. So Mark records, chapter Mark 16, verse 15, he said unto them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. That's what Mark is saying. The phrase is, preach the gospel. The same information is recorded by Matthew. He highlights little different way. Matthew chapter 28, verse 20 says, teach them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. So we see that Mark said, preach the gospel. The same thing he said, teach all my teachings, all my commandments, so that they may obey. So preaching the gospel is to obey the Lord Jesus Christ or obey his commandments. Inheritance in the kingdom of God is not a cheap thing. Your position in the government of the United States is a great thing. And it's not even an inheritance. There's no inheritance, no guarantee. We're not warned them. But still, it's a great position. And we have to stand for scrutiny for that position. If you look at the news and how the senators ask questions to that candidates, in a way, they insult them, they tore them apart, and all these kind of things. These people, in order to get the position, they have to stand a very humiliating, very hard scrutiny in front of those people. And if those things is for a position in a government, how much more we have to stand the scrutiny in order to inherit the kingdom of God, which is thousands of times more glorious than a position in the government. Christians look at this as a cheap and free commodity. The kingdom of God is not a free, cheap commodity. It is more glorious than rubies and diamonds and other whatever. I have no words to explain it. Let us see what is required of us to inherit heaven. What are the main things that we must do? We must do some other things because we have to obey the commandments of Jesus Christ. And preachers say, we can do all the things Jesus said, demands us to do. It is impossible. Look, Jesus is real, and he is not just giving up stories for you to give up, to give you a runaround. He means business. He wants to give you the kingdom. He wants you to qualify for the kingdom. He gives the specifics. It is possible for you to do, otherwise Jesus will not tell you that. He means business. His truth. And Jesus said in Matthew 6:37, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, with all thy mind. Preach this. Who can do this? All thy mind, all thy soul, all this. It is an impossible thing. That's what they do. And don't listen to them. Stick to the scriptures. Find out what the scriptures say. And keep going down and keep on reading it. God gives the explanations of those things. But at the same time, he told, so in John chapter 5, verse 42, he says, I know you that you have not the love of God in you. He is telling this to the religious people at that time. Even the religious people, the preachers and the celebrities and all those kind of people, they don't love God. They love their position, the money and fame and those kind of things. They teach any nonsense in order to keep their position. Jesus told them, Jesus will tell them even now, and said, you don't have the love of God. That's what they have. So don't listen to them. Listen to the scriptures. And now, he told in John 16, chapter 16, verse 27, he told his disciples, saying, the Father himself loveth you because you have loved me. The disciples loved Jesus. He told them, because you love me, God the Father loves you. The disciples loved him. So we must love Jesus in the same way that his disciples loved him. Then God the Father will love us. If we love, but the religious people don't love them, so don't follow them. But the thing is, we're talking about the love of the world. We cannot love him as we love our pets. We love our pets. Oh, we love dogs, we love parrots, and all this kind of thing. That's also love. That's not the kind of love. We must love him as the disciples loved him, with reverence. There's also an element of fear in it. So the second point is we must fear God. Luke chapter 1 verse 50 says his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. Matthew chapter 10 verse 28 says, and fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and the body in hell. That's God. So we must love God with fear. Love him and fear him at the same time. The next point, point number three, is we should not do harm to anybody. Listen to this. Let me read this. The Romans chapter 13. Romans 13. Romans 13 from verse 8. Verse 8 say, owe no man anything. Don't owe anybody anything. That means, you say, for an example, money. Don't borrow money and owe him. So you can give them money that way. So don't owe no man anything. That's not a big, hard commandment to do. Work hard something, find a job or whatever. Don't owe anything to anybody. But to love one another, for he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. Love one another. That also the people say, oh, we can love one another as you love yourself. That's not possible. So don't listen to those sermons. Listen here. For this, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet, and if there be any other commandments, it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. This is the commandments. They scare you by reading this and giving the interpretations of this verse. But listen, the verse next. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of law. So what he's saying is, verse 9 is one way of saying it, to scare people maybe. And verse 10 is saying, If you love your neighbor, you will not cheat him with his wife or something like that. You will not do harm to him. That's all he says. If you love him, you will not do harm to him. Put it this way. This passage is, you're talking about love the neighbor as thyself. He said, 2 points. You fulfill the law. It is, who says that? God says that. Not the preachers. God says that. But they say, 2 points. Verse 1 says, don't owe anything to anybody. And second point, don't hurt or don't do evil to your neighbor. As long as you don't do any evil to them, mind your business and don't do harm to anybody, is that a big deal? It is possible to do. Why the preachers say it is not possible, it is impossible, they say. It is possible not to hurt somebody else. Hurt somebody else is hard, rather than not hurt is easy. So, if you do these two things, you have obeyed these commandments. Any righteous person, any good person, any decent person can do this. And we do not have to be our brother's keeper. A lot of preachers preach we must be the brother's keeper. No. They preach it out of ignorance or in order to deceive you. If they want to keep their brothers, let them be brother's keepers. God did not tell you to be brother's keeper. He said, don't hurt them. So don't hurt them. So, next point. We must do good to all. So that's also there. If you can, it's possible for you to do good, you good to them, especially to the true believers in Christ. Galatians chapter 6, verse 10 says, as you have therefore opportunity, if you have opportunity, let us do good to all men. If you cannot do it, look, you, even if you are in the hole, how are you going to help others? If you have plenty and if you have the opportunity, if you have the means to help others, so help others. Help who? Not the rogues, not the criminals. Look, it says, especially to them who are of the household of faith, the righteous people, the good people, who believe God, who trust people, who trust God, and they're poor. So help them. And James chapter 4, verse 17 says, therefore, to him that knoweth to do good, you know how to do good. If you do it, not it is sin. So if you have the means to do it, and if you know how to do good, do good. That's not a hard thing to do. That's how you gain the inheritance in heaven. So, do good to others. In a nutshell, these are the summaries of the commandments of Jesus Christ. Are these things too much for a person to do in order to inherit the kingdom of God? Not at all. 1 John chapter 5, verse 3 says, for this is the love of God. If you love God, this is the love, that we keep the commandments. And his commandment is not grievous. It's the word of God says. His commandment is not grievous. Let somebody else not scare you. If you love Jesus Christ as our God, these commandments are not hard to obey. But if you love Jesus as one of our friends, or as one of the voluntary social workers, or one of our pets, or those kind of things, we will not do what he wants us to do. So that's the difference. Everybody love God. But how do you love God? You love God as you love your pet, or your as a friend, or love him as your master. But if we love still, but we still love our brother. Brother means we love a friend, love our buddies, and we love them. But the problem is, if we love Jesus Christ as his disciples loved him, or if you love him with respect, so that we may do what he tells us to do, in that level of respect, we will inherit his kingdom. And maybe 1 Corinthians chapter 2, 1 Corinthians chapter 2. First Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. As it is written, verse 9, as it is written, eye hath not seen, and ear heard, neither have entered into the hearts of men the things which God has prepared for them that love Him. If you love Him, the things God has prepared for us, even we could not even imagine, we could not even comprehend. It will not even enter into the hearts. That much of a glorious things, heavenly glorious things. There are no words to explain. God has prepared for us. It's a, I don't know how to explain it, and so, but you know, you have God, hearts cannot, it will not enter into our hearts. So, verse 10. But God hath revealed them into us by His Spirit. See, here goes the hint. For the Spirit searcheth all things, the deep things of God. So, only way you can understand is how? The Spirit of God, if that Spirit is in you, that reveals the things to you, what you are going to get. Otherwise, your education, your intelligence, whatever way you try to imagine, you cannot imagine heaven. That's how you take heaven is as cheap as you're taking it, because you have no understanding. But if you have the Spirit of God in you, that'll explain, that'll give you insight into the kingdom of God. You'll desire it and you'll love it. The reason you are not admired by it, because you don't have the Spirit of God. You must be born, really born of the Spirit of God, not the Spirit of the church, but the Spirit from God. You will know the deep things of God. Then you will seek after His kingdom. The Spirit of God will lead you, and you will inherit the kingdom of God. Religion will never take you there. Don't be satisfied with religion. It will deceive you. Seek God. He will guide you to His kingdom. He wants you to inherit it. Thank you for listening. God bless you. May His presence go with you. Amen.